This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Sports Files is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Tonight on the show, Ole Miss cleans house. Some weeks this show is easy. Some weeks, like this week, I have no idea where to begin. Should I begin at State College, Pennsylvania, where a former assistant football coach at Penn State is accused of sexually abusing young boys? Or should I begin at DeSoto Civic Center, where not long after this show ends, Rudy Gay will be hosting LeBron James, Chris Paul, and others in a charity basketball game? Or should I begin in the pages of the Commercial Appeal, which featured an op-ed by Memphis booster Mike Rose this past Sunday, defending R.C. Johnson and proclaiming that this is the athletic department's golden age? There's all that, plus the astonishing football game between LSU and Alabama this past weekend, plus this is a huge week of recruiting news for Memphis basketball. So what's a Sports Files host to do? Turn to Oxford, of course, where Houston Nutt and Pete Boone held separate press conferences yesterday to announce they would be stepping down. The changes seemed inevitable, honestly, after Ole Miss lost to Kentucky Saturday, but they come in the wake of a very public and sometimes nasty campaign by discontented Ole Miss fans to force a change of leadership. Did Ole Miss knuckle under to the demands of the discontented, or did Ole Miss respond appropriately to the concerns of its fan base? One of those fans is former Ole Miss quarterback Romaro Miller, who will join our panel tonight. We'll also have Sports Talk Radio host Rob Fischer and Fox 13's Matt Stark as we try to make sense of this busy and bewildering week. All that coming up next. As promised, joined now by my distinguished panel, Matt Stark from Fox 13. Matt, how are you?
Good to see you, Geoff.
Rob Fischer from Sports 56, the sports bar every single afternoon. Rob, thanks for coming here.
Good to see you, Geoff.
And Romaro Miller, former Ole Miss quarterback. I want to start, let's show the clip from yesterday with the news event as Houston Nutt steps down.
I want to thank Ole Miss for this opportunity. I want to thank the Rebel Nation for embracing my family. And what a great place to live. And last night we learned that the administration had decided to go in a different direction with this football program. I understand their decision and want you to know that I share with them the entire Ole Miss community its frustrations in not seeing the kind of on-the-field success we wanted the past two seasons.
Romaro, is that a good day for Ole Miss? Was that the right decision?
Well, I think after looking at the last couple of years, you know, Houston, he was a great guy, but, you know, college football, especially in the SEC, it come down to winning and losing. And, you know, we didn't obtain that on the football field. And, you know, he got with, the consequences of what happened when you lose.
Rob, thoughts?
Yeah, I think it's a good day for Ole Miss. I mean, it's been pretty depressing lately. And, you know, no matter how bad your season could be, you always have Kentucky and Vanderbilt below you. Well, they both blew Ole Miss out. You're the worst team in the SEC, and obviously there's been a call for change and a lot of disgruntled people in Oxford week in and week out, and it's not going to get better for the rest of the season. And yeah, I think change needed to be made, and I think it was a good time to make the change instead of waiting, because there's now a conclusion. It's over, and you know it's going to get better going forward.
The push to get for change was really directed more at Pete Boone than anyone else. Was this, Matt, is this knuckling under to the discontented? Dan Jones, the chancellor, had said, listen, I'm not going to react to this campaign. He tried to say yesterday that he didn't react. It obviously played into this. Is this negotiating with terrorists?
Somewhat, because, I mean, I think by not getting rid of him immediately with Coach Nutt, then you satisfy the I'm not going to negotiate with terrorist people. On the other hand,
letting him stay until next December.
Yes. Right. On the other hand, you let him stay now, so that takes care of the people who are saying we want him out. So you've kind of satisfied both. I didn't cave in to everybody that wanted him out right now, but you're also saying I hear you, and he does need to go. So here's when he's going.
Romero, you're one of the terrorists. I'm just kidding. But you joined this campaign in the sense that you wrote a column in which you basically said, I'm with the folks who want change. And then after you did it, Jarrell Poe, I mean, he wrote a letter saying that he never felt supported by Pete Boone. What was going on at Ole Miss?
Well, you know, I just think we're a divided fan base. And
is Pete Boone the point of division? Is it mostly around Pete? Was it around Pete more than anything else?
I think it's around a lot of stuff. And I think Pete was just the guy that, you know, he was the easy target because he was AD. Quite naturally, I'm quite sure if we'd have won more football games, I guess it wouldn't have been the bigger movement. But, you know, it works out like that. And, you know, he's the athletic director. So I think this was a lot of the reason why a lot of the fingers and a lot of the blame went to Pete.
As someone who joined the Forward Rebels campaign, are you satisfied? And do you get the sense that people, you know, he is going to stay here till next December. He will at least be on board when the next head coach will be picked, even if he's not picking the head coach. Are people really out for blood? Did he have to resign yesterday? Or is this sufficient to unite the divided Ole Miss family?
You know, I think so. You know, right now, the university went out and got Archie and Mike Glenn, you know, over the committee to going to pick the next head coach and the next AD. So you're talking about two of the guys who we know that love Ole Miss the most. And, you know, Archie, when it comes to picking up a phone and calling X coach or that coach, I mean, he's going to get you in. And, you know, for hearing what I'm hearing, that, you know, they actually want to be committed to winning. And, you know, we'll see how this search is going to turn out.
I asked Dan Jones yesterday, because there are people who will say, it's Ole Miss, it's not Alabama, and there are people who it's not LSU. And we're going to be back here in 4 years. I asked him about those circumstances and whether it's realistic to hope for championships at Ole Miss. And this is what he said. Let's go to the clip of Dan Jones.
So do we have a tougher set of circumstances than some of our competitors? For sure, we do. Can we win championships here? Absolutely. And, you know, we all need to believe in that. So we are a part of the most competitive conference in the country, and that's where we want to be and where we need to be.
Do you believe in that? Can they win championships at Ole Miss?
Sure. It is more difficult, but you have to be creative. You have to be innovative, whether that's from an athletic director or that's from a head coach of a football team. I think it's similar to Oklahoma State. And look what they're doing in the Big 12. They have no reason to be competing in the Big 12.
Except going they have Oklahoma. A booster who came in
and
wrote checks and wrote checks and wrote checks.
Well, and they have great facilities. Ole Miss has nice facilities, really nice facilities. I think it's a matter of you have to change a style. You have to get a coach that's going to make kids want to come play there. Mike Gundy has kids wanting to go play there because they can put up video game numbers week in and week out. That's what you're going to have to do. You're not going to be able to go line up against Alabama and say, we're going to win these games by defense. Let's go get defensive play, because you're not going to be able to compete against those schools. You got to do something different, and you have to do something different that makes it unique and makes kids want to come there. And you know, Houston Nutt wasn't getting the job done recruiting-wise. I mean, my goodness, they changed the rule with the signing because he signed 37 players a few years ago. Only 15 of those guys are still on the team. 15 of 37, only 7 have started this year. That's horrible.
You realize you're bringing facts to this show?
We
had a strict rule. I thought we agreed in advance.
I mean, that's too much risk taking.
Can they win titles at Ole Miss, Matt?
Here's a number. They hadn't lost to Vandy and Kentucky in the same year since 1950. So there's my stat. What was the question? I was prepared too. I just wanted that.
Let's go to the expert. Romero, can they win titles at Ole Miss?
You know, I think you can. I think it takes a major commitment. And hopefully this is the change that we're looking for. You know, I told somebody the other day that, you know, people say you can't win in Mississippi. But I say, why not? You know, there's high school talent there. And I look at a school like Wisconsin. There's no high school talent in Wisconsin, but they're in the top 10 every year. How's a school like that getting it done, and a school like Ole Miss can't get it done? So hopefully change is about to come, and we'll see what happens.
I mentioned Oklahoma State. I mean, Northwestern's gone to Rose Bowl.
Stanford. Look at Stanford now. They've got a
position for a national championship. Yeah. Northwestern went to a Rose Bowl out of the Big Ten, which is incredible. So it can be done. It is difficult. It's going to be tough. It's tough for Ole Miss. It's tough for State. It's tough for Kentucky. It's tough for Vanderbilt, certainly. But it can be done because, you know, Alabama and LSU aren't going to be the dominant undefeated teams year in and year out like they are right now. Things go in cycles, and you just have to build and build and build and get a chance. I mean, they were one win away in Eli's last year when LSU came down to Oxford. One win from getting to Atlanta.
You mentioned commitment. Romaro, you said before we got on the air that there's no nutritionist, for example. Is that, I mean, where, how does commitment, you walk down there, the facilities, the indoor practice facilities is as handsome as anyone's. What's commitment look like?
Well, you know, I just say players talk. And you're going to bring a four-star, five-star recruit to Oxford. And the players on the team are going to tell them some of the things that's going on. You're going to take them to Alabama. You're going to take them to Tennessee. Those players are going to tell. So
you think a player will notice the difference right now who visits Ole Miss and who visits Alabama?
Oh, without a doubt.
Without a doubt. Mm-hmm. In everything. Just sort of in.
You know, I just think so. But, you know, a change is coming. And,
all right, let's talk about that. I'm going to get to the AD in a minute. Matt, do you have a coach for us? You've got a list in your pocket.
Everyone's got a list, right?
Everyone's got to have a list in the pocket.
I think you start, as we've talked about, Gus Malzahn would be a good start. Talked about Rich Rodriguez. He's another big offensive guy. We said you can't do a defense. He's put up points everywhere he's been. Granted, I'm a Rich Rod fan. But those are I would probably start at Malzahn because he's familiar with the SEC. And, of course, we also talked about the great idea of following Houston Nutt. How much would he like that, to follow Coach Nutt then and maybe do it with
Handy
his players?
Is how do you feel about – do you have a list, Romaro? You don't have a list.
You know, actually, I don't have a list. I'm just, for the first time, I'm just going to follow. You know, Archie's in control of this deal, man, and – I know he got a lot of connections out in the coaching world and things like that. And, you know, just whoever he picks, I'm going to support 100%.
You are. Do you have faith in the combination of Archie and Mike Glenn who will be making this choice?
I truly do.
You do. Mm-hmm. And when you say you're going to obviously, listen, Ole Miss is not Alabama in terms of its resources right now. It's at that much of a greater disadvantage when you're split in two. Mm-hmm. Do you feel like people are now prepared to rally around whoever the new coach is?
I feel like we are. And like I said, a change sometimes is a good thing. And right now is the perfect time for it. But whoever Archie and Mike bring in and the committee bring in, I'm going to support 100% because I know those guys are going to do. They love the university, and they're going to do what's best for the university. So I'm praying and hoping they hit a home run on this one.
Who's your list?
I would hate to be praying and hoping for a good coach because that makes me feel like you have a little doubt that it might happen. To me, you start.
But I mean, how many times you look at, in the end, and this is, I'm sorry to interrupt, but this is my show. So,
I do the same thing every day.
In the end, though, people will roll their eyes and they'll say, oh, Missy, we're going to be back here in 4 years. Well, how many coaches did Alabama have to go through before they got to Nick Saban? That's what you're supposed to do. You take your shot. If you miss, I hate to say it, they print money in the SEC now, then you take another shot. You give the next guy $6 million. It may be obscene, but isn't that what you do? You just take your best shot?
Absolutely. I'm unsure of this committee because I wonder, you know, what football today is different. You know, the guys that Archie played with, the guys that Archie knows as coaches. And I don't know. Maybe he's out there a lot more than I even realize, but to me, you need the young, innovative guy. Gus Malzahn is, to me, the perfect choice, and he's your number one guy. And
why does he take that when he turned down? It's a hard job.
It's not as hard as Vanderbilt. Plus, if you offered him, Ole Miss is going to, you know, you talk about commitment. Commitment's going to be paying a lot of money, overpaying for a coach. Gus Malzahn turned down, what, $2 million from Vanderbilt?
Right.
$3 million. We'll give you $3 million. You're replacing Houston Nutt. You hire the staff and just go with it. I think that would get people excited. Mike Leach, I think, would get people excited. You know, a guy who's won everything that he's done. Those are
okay,
two guys that I like.
Mike, you bring up Mike Leach. Can they hire Mike Leach with all the baggage? And this raises that systemic problem. Can they hire Mike Leach with all the baggage he has when you don't have the AD who will ultimately be supervising him in place?
It narrows your search. I think you cross people off once you hire Romaro Mike Leach.
Can you hire Mike Leach?
I think this is going to be tough. You know, one thing about Mike Leach is he's going to put points on the board. And I just remember last year I got into talk about people leaving the games at halftime. People don't leave at halftime with Mike Leach. So
the thing about Mike Leach and the thing that I like about him is that he won games, put himself in position potentially for a national championship with lesser talent. And at Ole Miss, you can get great players in the state. Right, you can get this. SEC talent, but it's less talent than those other schools.
I'm going to cut away. Let's have a, we have a clip of Houston Nutt talking about the situation that he's – what he's left his successor with. Let's go to this clip of Houston Nutt.
Fans of the program can be especially excited about the future of the program. There's no doubt in my mind. You're not far off.
Not far off, Romero?
I think there's a lot of work to be done. I think there's a lot.
There is young talent, though. When you look at the, no, he laughs out loud at the not far.
Again, 37 recruits, only 15 are on the team, and only 7 play.
They don't have a quarterback.
And you don't have a quarterback.
Most of their lines leaving. Their running backs are going.
It's a lot of work.
I mean, he blew up the whole quarterback situation. Yeah. And yesterday, he put it on Jevon. That's the reason they're no good. He ran Jevon out of town, and Jevon was a great quarterback,
Houston,
a throwing quarterback who didn't throw.
Will Houston not ever be a head coach again? He said he wanted to be.
Sure.
He said he's got another 5, 7, 8, 10
sure.
years. Yes?
In the Conference Mountain
Sun Belt.
West USA Conference.
All right, we have to hit some other topics here. And I'm going to start with you, Rob. There's an NBA exhibition game. You are the sideline reporters for the Grizzlies when you are not unemployed from that position,
right.
when that job exists. Can you go to that game, by the way? Can you go to this game tonight? You can.
I'm currently unemployed.
You're currently unemployed. Yeah. Do you have a take on it? Situation?
Good deal for charity. You know, good for Rudy's charity foundation. And I think fans will be entertained.
I
hate preseason basketball, exhibition basketball, Globetrotters. That's what you're going to see. It's going to resemble nothing to
but
basketball.
It's LeBron.
It doesn't mean anything.
Are you excited about it, Matt?
I wish people were more excited about it. Sounds like there's an awful lot of tickets still left. I mean, this is your only chance right now. I mean, it's going to be a dunk fest, but, I mean, you will see LeBron James. Theoretically, he's going to be there tonight in person. You see some all-star. I mean, there's a lot of talent coming. And if you're a basketball diehard one, you just want to see the stars up close.
But we love it because we love team and we love that games mean something. This
Absolutely.
Doesn't mean anything.
True.
All right, next topic. You all watched LSU-Alabama. Let's start with you, Romero. Was that a great exhibition of SEC football, or was it? Did it set the game back 40 years?
You know, for myself, I'm a quarterback, so I love points on the board. So if you're not scoring, I don't like it. But I will say I was truly impressed with that game. And, you know, I wouldn't mind seeing it again. I don't know if it'll happen. But, man, those are two great defenses. I mean, against everybody else, LSU and Alabama, they're scoring 30-plus points. Against those two defenses, they can't score.
It's true. They're scoring 40 points. And yet when you – I don't think we can consider those great teams when they don't have court. I mean, LSU, wasn't there a moment where you said, just put me out there and I can complete a pass? I mean, they literally can't throw.
Well, I tell you, man, it just, you know, I got to catch myself because, you know, you get on, you watching it on TV and you can see stuff. But, man, when you get out there and you got Hightower coming, running at you, running a 4-3 and a 4-4.
He's a big man.
everything changes up real quick.
Matt, great exhibition of football or set the game back 40 years?
I wouldn't say set it back. I mean, these quarterbacks I didn't love it. I mean, these quarterbacks aren't as bad, I think, as they looked. I think what Romero just said at touchdown, these defenses are really good and are going to make the quarterbacks look bad. Tom Brady looked bad the other day. Is it because he suddenly got bad or because the defense have been playing pretty good against him? I'd watch it again. It beats the alternative. I mean, the SEC championship game, is anybody excited about watching LSU pound South Carolina into the ground? No thanks.
Rob.
It was a great exhibition of NFL defense, I think is what that game was. I thought it was a great game. It reminded me a lot of other sports kind of game 7. Whoever made that first mistake, it was going to cost them, and if someone took advantage, the game was going to be over.
Well, not exactly true, because the Alabama kicker made 4 or 5 mistakes on his own.
I was stunned that that team made some of the mistakes, and I thought Les Miles kind of tamed his act down a little bit because of how the game was going on. It was a great chess match. I loved watching the game. I don't want to see it again. I have no interest
in
seeing it.
I'm with you. I thought, for my criticism to the quarterback, I thought it was incredibly compelling, cannot look away stuff. The level of defense is extraordinary. But when Alabama loses at home to LSU, what's the argument that they should be able to play them on a neutral field? Is there any argument, Romero?
Nope, there's no argument.
They're done, right?
Yep, they're done.
Yes?
Stanford, I don't know. I think the SEC is the best conference in America.
Yeah, but we know which team won.
I can tell you what's going to happen when LSU plays whoever in the championship anyway.
It's unfair to LSU to have them
that
play
is,
Alabama.
I agree with that.
Let Oklahoma State have a shot. If they go undefeated, let's see if they can stop them.
All right, and then we do have to talk about what has happened at Penn State. Today, Joe Paterno canceled his press conference. Obviously, this is a story that is bigger than sports, has nothing to do with sports in some way. The former assistant there charged with sexually abusing young boys and told, and Joe Paterno knew about this, and he was not even banned from campus. Essentially, this was not taken to the cops. Can and should Joe Paterno survive this, Rob?
I mean, I hate talking about the story. It's uncomfortable because it's disgusting. It's horrible. Any word you want to use to describe it. The football part of it really is so secondary, as you mentioned, that I don't know. I don't know what should happen there. I just hope there's a quick resolution.
There can't possibly be a quick resolution. I mean, it's going to be in courts for Romero. I mean, can you imagine Joe surviving this?
I can't see it. I think Joe's going to go down and some other people's going to go down. It didn't start and it didn't stop with him, and other people knew about it. And, you know, he is going to have to roll on this one.
The incompetence shown at different levels of leadership is mind-blowing. The fact the president has been MIA now, other than a blanket statement, the fact that they did actually ban him from campus, I believe, in 2002, yet they let this guy still run camps at their satellite branches
is
mind-blowing. And the fact that, I'm one of the people, again, let's let the facts play out, let's hear everything. It's tough to try not to rush to judgment, but at the same time, I don't see how Paterno survives this. And this is the opportunity then to usher him out, as well as the president, the athletic director, everybody involved.
And does it have anything to? It has nothing to do with football at some level, but does it at the level that, because it's so powerful? I mean, people said Joe Paterno reported to his AD, his boss, what happened. But there's nobody who's Joe Paterno's boss at Penn State. We all know that. Joe Paterno is the boss at Penn State. And I do wonder if, just like the Catholic Church was trying to protect the Catholic Church over the children who were in its care, people here were trying to protect the football program over the kids who are in there.
I think it's very difficult to put ourselves in this position. I mean, imagine a friend of yours, a dear friend of yours for 30 years, a dear friend, and all of a sudden you hear this about him, and you take it to your bosses, they say they investigate, and they found nothing.
But if you saw your dear friend with 8 to 10-year-old boys the next year and the next year and the next year.
And here's
year,
the point. Wouldn't you talk to your dear friend and say, dear friend, what in God's name are you doing? What is this I'm hearing? What's happening? And apparently none of that went down. He reported to his boss and that was it. And then suddenly this guy that was next in line just vanishes off that, and then suddenly he's banned from campus. Somebody knew what was going on, and there's a cover-up underway.
There are at least rumors, and they probably didn't look into it enough.
I do not blame... actually Joe Paterno for canceling the press conference today, because there is nothing to say except I resign and we'll let the beyond that, what was he going to say? But I've never seen anything like it. And will you remember him, Romero, like you remember Woody Hayes, or like you remember, I mean, is this stain his reputation, or is he still, I mean, in the end, what he's known for more than anything else is integrity.
Yeah.
And it's besmirched, isn't it?
I think it is a little bit. Well, actually a lot. But, you know, people still going to remember that he won X amount of football games. But, yeah, he did hurt it a little bit.
All right. Thank you very much for coming. I appreciate it. Back with the wrap after one question.
For those who are concerned about the mascot, I say there are other more important issues for our university other than the mascot. If we look at our peer universities in the Southeastern Conference, we have fine universities who have done well for a number of years with a pig and with a chicken as their mascots. And it would seem that if they can deal with a chicken and a pig, that, you know, a black bear won't pull us down too far.
So Boston Celtics point guard Rajon Rondo took to Twitter the other day to object to the NBA's offer of a 50-50 split of revenues between the owners and the players. What entertainer gives up 50%, he asked. So here's a news flash for Rondo. You're not Beyonce or Jay-Z or even Paul Simon, for that matter. You're a guy who dunks a basketball. That's a fine skill, mind you. I wish I could do it. But sports fans don't fill up arenas to watch the sheer artistry before them. They fill up arenas to pull for their city's team. They're going to watch the Boston Celtics or the Los Angeles Lakers or the Memphis Grizzlies. They're going to root their guts out for the name on the front of the shirt. By way of evidence, look at what's happening at DeSoto Civic Center tonight, where a truly astonishing collection of basketball talent is playing an exhibition game. LeBron James is supposed to be there, along with Rudy Gay and Chris Paul and others. And as of this morning, they hadn't managed to give away or sell more than 5,000 seats. In other words, sheer basketball artistry can't sell out a single game on a single night. The Grizzlies play 41 games at FedEx Forum. This isn't to demean the gifts of the players either. They're remarkable athletes. But somewhere along the line, they became divas. They forgot where they fit in the scheme of things. Jerry Seinfeld had a great quote about this. "We root for laundry," he said. Yes, it's wonderful to watch Zach Randolph and Tony Allen play ball, but it's especially wonderful because they're playing for Memphis, because they're representing us. The players at the Civic Center, by contrast, are representing nobody but themselves. So here's hoping the players come to their senses in the next day or so. It's time for sanity to prevail. A Grizzlies jersey may be laundry, but I miss it just the same. And that's it for Sports Files this week. You can always write the show at sportsfiles@wkno.org. To watch the show online, go to wkno.org and click on KNO Tonight. Until next week, come on back, guys.